You're watching The Dish TV, the talk show from SRI International that highlights the most important part of our institute, our people. I'm Reenita Malhotra Hora, Head of Marketing and Communications, and today I'm joined by Manish Kothari, President of SRI International. In part one of this interview, I ask Manish about how artificial intelligence will impact healthcare and medicine in the future and how SRI's research is supporting these areas.
If you look at different industries and look at the level of automation and intelligence in those industries, healthcare is one of the least penetrated industries. Most things are manual. Most things are done by humans for humans. And there is a reason for that. Those tasks are complex. They're not easy to predict what will come next. They require more than just physical support in some cases. They require chemistry support in some cases. They require emotional support in some cases. So medicine has traditionally been, and healthcare in general, has traditionally been something that has been very hard for advanced technologies to crack. That is changing now, and it's changing for a multitude of reasons. Number one, there are new analytics that allow us to pull patterns out of very large data sets that were not available previously. In the past, you had a physician learning from their teachers and then doing a fellowship and learning from their teachers in the fellowship, and that became their knowledge base on which they derived their approach to problems. They also read a lot of literature when possible. All of those techniques meant that every physician actually had a very limited base of which of learning to base off of. Today, with easy access to journals, that has become simpler. That's not digital medicine. That's just the internet making life a lot easier, and that has changed a lot of things. But now when you extend that to what other physicians are doing, can we get data sets from other hospitals? Can we analyze what did you do in these situations? Those technologies allow a sea change. I mean, let me give an example. Mm-hmm. So if you have a pediatric disease, and let's say you're at Stanford, there aren't enough cases even at Stanford to truly analyze what the next best step might be or what historical data has suggested it might be. But now you can start porting in data from Johns Hopkins, Harvard, UCSF, and you can do it in a way that still preserves anonymity and come up with enough data to start asking, what would I do if this child of 11 is having this problem mm-hmm. and needs, if I do this treatment, what have been the outcomes? If I do that treatment, what have been the outcomes? That couldn't be done 5 years ago.
So this is interesting. I am assuming we're talking about perhaps AI-powered analytic systems.
Both the value of AI in healthcare has been both underrepresented and overhyped. So a doctor can go now and say, hey, what if I want to optimize for this criteria? What have other people done? And you are able to do that. You can now say, well, I don't want to optimize for this. I want to optimize for the most convenience or the lowest cost or the most effectiveness. And you can get answers for that. So the system itself cannot find out the exact optimal answer, but it can, given an optimization criteria, which is often determined by the physician, come up with supporting evidence that helps the physician make the right decision. In the near future, that's what we're likely to see, AI augmented human medicine, if you will.
Where does augmented reality, virtual reality, mixed reality play into this? Does it play into this?
Well, let me ask you a question back. How many times do you think a surgeon is tested after they finish their fellowship? The answer is zero.
Zero?
Zero times.
Whoa.
But you have a situation where modern technologies like virtual reality are uniquely suited to give them an immersive experience that they can train themselves prior to the surgery. And surgeons are great at this. They don't need complex training, but this is just a reminder in an immersive world that lets them remember, okay, I turn right here for this instrument, I do this there for that instrument. It makes all the difference. You can then also monitor those and use those as training and testing enterprises if you wish. So this is a situation where virtual reality can actually make a very, very big difference. And these great experiments out of Stanford that have shown that if you immerse a person into a body that is not of their type, say male to female or African American to Caucasian, you develop a sense of empathy that actually lasts for a fairly significant amount of time after, like months after you've done that experience.
So going forth, looking into the future, is the aim of digital health technology to empower the physician or to empower the patient, or both?
It's really both. Today, it's impossible for you to know what is the next step and what is the next step for you in medicine. If you had something that let you understood that you have multiple chronic comorbidities and you are experiencing this symptom, maybe the answer is talk to a doctor now. But that could be immensely valuable rather than you wondering, should I wait another week, should I not? So it can empower the patient. It will most definitely empower the physician. And I think it can also empower the whole healthcare system, because the patient and the physician, though the central elements of medicine, are not the only elements. It's the hospital, it's the clinic, it's the insurer, it's all of those are also around. I mean, how do you reduce medical claims malpractice, right? How do you improve adjudication of bills? These are all things that medicine badly needs that it can do.
So Manish, can you tell me about some of the programs in this area that are coming out of SRI?
Sure. So as SRI does research in a broad number of areas, so we have been working on a number of areas related to digital health, and I'll go over a few of them. Today, from the idea that is conceived in a lab that this may be a good target to go after to address a particular type of drug, say lung cancer, it is 15 years from that first identification that a medicine is released. If there were a way to cut the 15 years to 10 years, or cut the cost down from $1 billion to $500 million, it could have a dramatic impact in the world. SRI has created platforms such as one called Symphony that actually automate the entire process of early molecular discovery. It is also very active in using concepts of advanced artificial intelligence, or next generational artificial intelligence, and applying them to healthcare. SRI has been very active in the areas of explainable AI, working on a number of DARPA programs. And to the extent that we can use those techniques to provide some explanation back to any specialist, and especially a specialist like the physician, it is immensely valuable. And maybe the third area I'll talk about is the area of robotics. Mm-hmm. So you have multiple uses of robotics in medicine. We've all heard about intuitive surgical, which, by the way, SRI created 20, 30 years ago. We've heard about Verb Surgical that was just bought by J&J, which, again, by the way, SRI helped work on and seed while here over the last decade. But there are other uses as well. How can you create better inventory management and tracking of all the instruments used? How can you make sure that there isn't bioburden on these instruments? These are all very important things to ensure infection rates go down, which has a profound impact on both the cost and the quality of life for the patient and the cost to the hospital and insurers. These are things that we're working on with our advanced robotic solutions.